Hey, everyone. Thanks. My thanks to the organizers for the opportunity to speak today. I'm going to give an update and talk about the recent breakthrough in our team, and that is around being able for the first time since the isolation of the RHDV, rabbit hemorrhagic disease virus, being able to culture it and grow it outside of rabbits in the lab. We've been able to do it using a platform called hepatobiliary organoids or liver organoids. We can see a snapshot of them on the right side of these, right side of the slides. So that is what they look like under the microscope. More details on them coming up. But before that, let's focus on the last three words of the title, directed virus evolution, and the main use of this platform. Okay, too many times. All right. So, as we're all aware of, biocontrol measures, we've, you know, I've had many of them, and we know how effective they are in reducing rabbit populations, but they lose effectiveness. That's, you know, hence we need the long-term strategy for biocontrol of rabbits. This loss of effectiveness basically happens because of the evolution, or more accurately, the co-evolution of both the virus and also the host. In this case, for example, RHDV and the rabbits. And this evolution happens because they've got basically two items on their agenda: to stay alive and stay around for as long as possible, and spread your genes for as long as possible. And those two agendas, they do not match with our agenda of suppressing rabbit populations. So the question is, can we basically stop the evolution? Is it possible to completely halt it and not have those agendas happening? The answer is no, it's impossible to stop the evolution. However, it is possible to guide it or direct it and steer it towards the outcome and characteristics that we want, and that is the reduction of rabbit population. Sense the importance of this platform, because in order to guide this evolution and direct it in the direction that we want, we need to have a fully and thoroughly controlled environment that we can have basically our agenda and our needs met within that controlled environment, hence the importance of such platform to just grow it in the lab. As I said, I'll be focusing on RHDV as one of the most recent biocontrol measures, that we know how effective it is, we know how virulent it is, and how we can reduce the rabbit population, with the downside of it being almost a 40-year-old mystery, because we haven't had this cell culture system, so all the studies have been very limited for this virus, and information, very critical information, such as like virulence factors and host range and things like that, have been very much limited because of the lack of such a system. But although the cell culture didn't exist, it's still not impossible to direct evolution or study the virus. It's still, we have the susceptible animal, the rabbits, to study, and that's what exactly our team has done in the past. So, for example, in this case of experimental evolution, you know, rabbits get infected with the virus, and then we put some evolutionary pressure, selective pressure on them, in this case, for example, antibodies, and after several generations, the virus progeny, the virus output coming out of these rabbits has now steered towards a population of virus that is now, it can go around that certain immune response, for example. Now, if we keep doing that over generations and generations of rabbits, the virus that reaches the last passage in this case, is able to grow and overcome immune responses at really high levels, and looking at its structure and the changes that it has accumulated, we can see that, we've seen that the changes on its surface proteins can definitely be accumulated, and that is, you know, the surface of it, the most important part, it interacts with the immune system. So this was a proof of concept. This is proof that it is possible to direct the evolution and accumulate the characteristics and features that we want in this virus if we it is possible to direct it. However, the downside being all the number of rabbits that we need to basically have in this process, it's not cost effective. It's not, it takes a long time to do that, and the output being just one new candidate for biocontrol that needs a lot of characterization. It had to be parked until very recently. That we overcome this 40-year-old challenge of being able to finally culture the non-cultivable virus. So the way we were able to do it was basically to switch from preparing cells in a monolayer in a dish, which usually works for most viruses. You just take the tissue, break down the cells, and put them in a dish, and that is good enough for the virus to be able to grow in them. Not for this virus. It needed more of the characteristics of the original tissue to be preserved in the cell population in order to be able to support its replication. So instead of that monolayer of cells, we switched to advanced 3D cell culture. That means the cells coming out of these tissues now, instead of a flat dish, they were placed in a 3D structure, a 3D scaffold, and the growth of stem cells that are responsible for regeneration of this tissue were encouraged, and that was the key that finally sort of kept enough original features of the tissue to allow it to support the replication of this virus. And this is what they look like under the microscope, these spherical structures, multicellular structures that are able to support the virus, and also we can break them down and turn them into the same flat monolayer for ease of experiments. And this is what the results look like. For example, when we infect them on day one, we can see the quantity of the virus increases at the later time point when we measure it, and that is basically the evidence for this platform being able to support the replication of the virus. All details are now published in Journal of General Virology. I'm happy to answer any questions you might have. And other challenges after being able to grow the virus was being able to kind of repeat the same thing that we had done with the rabbit. So we have now this new generation of the virus. The platform has supported it. And that is what we see in the first attempt of culturing it. Like we've got the day one and day three, things increase. But now we want to passage it if we want the next generation of the virus in order to, for the evolution to be possible. Now we need to take this progeny, new virus, and put it in the culture again and keep doing that and have several consecutive generations of the virus to see the effect. And that was something that wasn't happening. So in the first passage, yes, it was, we could see the increase, and by the second and by the third passage, it was gone. So that was, again, something that couldn't be used in experimental evolution because it only supports one generation of it, and that's not good enough. We investigated several things, and one of the possible answers and issues that could be addressed to fix this was interference. Interference are the molecules that are produced when a cell is infected by virus. That cell produced these interference to basically alert the rest of the uninfected cells to shut down the gates because there's a virus around, and that was the case here as well. So we're able to add and Okay, yeah, just inhibitor molecule that would basically inhibit this interferon response, and so rest of the cells would still remain infectable. That fixed the problem. So in passages, consecutive passages, we could see still we could see the increase, kind of solve that problem, and we went from only having one successful replication of the virus to all the way to several passages, and that kind of solved the issue. So now we can have several generations of the virus created in this platform. And so theoretically, we should be able to repeat what the same experiment that we had in rabbits. This time on these cells, we just add the initial variant. It could be the one of the RHDVs in circulation. Then the selective pressure is being added, like the antibodies, monoclonal antibodies in this case, and after several generations of the virus, the second in brand new variant can be produced, and then we can use the same platform to assess its different characteristics and see if it is a suitable, for example, candidate for the next biocontrol, at least in theory. Here I'm also showing another step of optimization of the system. So all the blue dots here are representing one cell nuclei. So we're looking at a flat lawn of cells here in the first image here. Second one, we have infection with RHDV2. The green signal there is showing us the presence and replication of RHDV2. And after adding the inhibitor that I just talked about, we've managed to increase the efficiency of this infection and get a lot more cells infected, in some cases even up to 100% of the cells in that particular well, in a particular dish, were infected with it, which is how efficient the system is in supporting growth of this virus. Now, one other application of the of this method is that we can actually test the host specificity of different variants of the virus as well. In the same way that we've made liver organoids out of rabbits, we're able to do it with hare livers, mouse, fox, cat as well. And the application of that would be to see if the same host range also is mimicked and captured in this platform as well, which was the case, exactly like we don't see any active infection in other predators and other vertebrate pests in nature, and it was exactly reflected in this platform as well. So to summarize all the applications and benefits of this system, well, it provides a fantastic platform to get into the details and all the unanswered questions that are answered for all rest of the viruses except this one. It allows us to find out different, how does the host specificity work? Like we've seen some new species getting infected. What is the change there? What is the factor that determines that? Or the virulence, you know, how virulent this virus is, and can we increase that, decrease that? Can we dial it up and down? That is still a question. What is its receptor? How does it get into the cells? Or to simply quantify it without the need for so many rabbits. And by the way, those rabbits used in those experiments and also in quantifications, we can't just use any, capture some wild rabbits and then use it. It has to be done in a controlled environment and all free of all the pathogens, because we want to have all of that control. So that again adds to the problem. And one other thing important again is vaccines, because all the biocontrol agents, but also we want to reduce the population of the rabbits, and there are other rabbits that we don't want to kill, and we need to vaccinate them. Again, having such platform is an amazing tool in vaccine manufacturing as well. So, yeah, reduces the number of animals required in these in these experiments, and plus, theoretically, we should be able to resume the RHDV accelerator strategy, have these new biocontrols based on RHDV produced, and be able to characterize them and assess their suitability for to be used as future biocontrols. And with that, I will thank our amazing lab members, our collaborators, funders, supporters, and you guys for listening.